On a moonlit night off the California coast, a strange and angular vessel glides silently and seamlessly from the side of a massive barge. Her movements are quiet and deliberate, but her unusual shape seems to shift with each passing moment. At one angle, she appears as a sloped trapezoid, at another, a jagged shard glinting in the moonlight. Then something upright and almost otherworldly, defying every expectation of what a ship should be. But the most advanced sensors, sonar, radar, or even infrared, register nothing. Her presence is an enigma, as if she simply doesn't exist. From the early 1980s until April 1993, the United States Navy maintained that illusion. After all, this vessel was the Sea Shadow, America's only known attempt to vanish on the water as effectively as the F-117 stealth fighter does in the air. The announcement. In April 1993, a brief and tightly worded memo emerged from the Pentagon. The document revealed, for the very first time, the existence of an unusual Navy project, a necessity, the paper claimed, brought about solely by the need for daylight testing. The timing seemed deliberate, designed to minimize attention, and the details remained tightly controlled. The Navy allowed reporters a single opportunity to see the vessel, scheduling the event early on Easter morning. Even then, questions were met with carefully worded answers, and public affairs officers were barred from straying beyond approved statements. Only a few sparse details were offered. The ship was 160 feet long, 70 feet wide, and displaced 560 tons, with a draft measuring 14 feet. Officially, this mystery ship's purpose was described as, quote, to explore the application of a variety of advanced technologies to surface ships. These technologies involve ship control, structures, automation, seakeeping, and signature control. Of course, signature control is simply military jargon for stealth. Her construction had been entirely shrouded in secrecy for nearly a decade, carried out at Lockheed Missiles and Space Company's hidden facility in Redwood City, California. As part of the Defense Department's classified projects, or black programs, the $200 million undertaking had officially not existed until then. And her story was a doozy. New technology. In the 1980s, a new kind of threat was beginning to dominate ocean warfare. Radar-guided, sea-skimming missiles. Best exemplified by the French Exocet, these new tools quickly became the weapon of choice for smaller, less equipped navies. With this relatively simple and far more accessible technology, nations that could not match the size or firepower of a mighty United States carrier gained a shortcut to inflict devastating damage. Launched from patrol boats, helicopters, or attack planes, these missiles closed in on their targets at near supersonic speeds, flying mere feet above the water. With a radar cross-section so small that they often appeared no bigger than a bird, by the time they crested the horizon, the ship's crew would have only seconds to react. And no defensive measures, chaff clouds, missile interceptors, not even close-in gun systems offered a major guarantee of survival. Just one of these missiles, armed with a few hundred pounds of high explosives, could cripple even the most modern warship. As former Navy Captain John McGilvray put it, quote, if a ship gets hit by a cruise missile, I think it's fair to say their fighting for the day is over. No better example of this technology was the U.S. frigate Stark, which was hit by two Exocets on May 17, 1987, during the Iran-Iraq War. While her crew's damage control efforts did eventually save the ship, dozens of sailors lost their lives. At the same time, the Cold War arms race pushed the United States to maintain technological superiority. The Soviet Union had already made significant advances in missile and submarine technology, and U.S. naval planners knew they could not afford to fall behind. With more than 15,000 of these sea-skimming missiles deployed across at least 50 navies all over the world, the United States needed a dramatic shift in how warships were designed. Around this time, Skunk Works had already started looking beyond the skies. Time out. In 1978, a photographer at Skunk Works, the pseudonym for Lockheed Martin's advanced development programs, complained that his Polaroid camera was malfunctioning. No matter how hard he tried, the images of a model F-117 stealth fighter he was trying to capture were coming out blurry. Noticing the strange phenomena, Ben Rich, head of Skunkworks, intervened with a grin, yelling, quote, "Time out. There isn't one thing wrong with your new camera." What Rich noticed was that the issue wasn't the equipment. It was the stealth technology of the aircraft itself, as its radar-absorbing coatings and faceted angles were throwing off the camera's sonar-based autofocus. He knew that what couldn't be clearly seen couldn't be properly captured. For Rich, this was more than just a quirky mishap. It was a eureka moment. Stealth, once the exclusive domain of aircraft, offered a tantalizing solution for surface fleets. Reducing a vessel's radar profile to buy critical seconds in an engagement, or much better, avoid detection entirely. With this potentially revolutionary idea in their hands, Rich's team began exploring how this technology could work underwater, testing crude submarine prototypes with sharp, angular surfaces meant to deflect sonar waves. The results of these trials were astonishing. The sonar reflections had been reduced to just a fraction of what they had been, making the models virtually undetectable. However, Rich and his team soon learned the hard way that submarines weren't the Navy's top priority for stealth. After several failed pitches to Pentagon officials, it seemed like the concept would remain a fascinating but unfulfilled experiment. However, in an unexpected twist, Rich learned about the Navy's SWAT design, or Small Waterplane Area Twin Hull prototype. Unlike traditional ships, SWAT had two submerged hulls connected to the main deck by thin struts, drastically reducing the vessel's resistance to waves. Lauded by Navy designers for their remarkable stability and impressive speed in rough seas, it offered a unique platform for stealth experiments. This was just the breakthrough he needed. Now, with support from Defense Undersecretary Bill Perry, Rich secured funding for a surface ship prototype that would incorporate stealth shaping and radar-absorbing materials. However, to make the concept a reality, the project needed secrecy and a lot of space, somewhere far from prying eyes, at a location that even the most seasoned defense insiders wouldn't expect. Hidden in plain sight. In 1973, Hughes Mining Barge 1, or HMB-1, was launched for one of the Cold War's most secretive missions, Project Azorian. For this operation, the CIA commissioned the vessel for a critical Cold War mission, retrieving the sunken Soviet submarine K-129 from the Pacific Ocean floor. Designed to flood her ballast tanks and submerge completely, HMB-1 could conceal its activities from satellites and observers, operating more like a submarine than a traditional barge. Stationed in Redwood City, California, HMB-1 was originally paired with the Glomar Explorer, supporting the daring salvage operation with her unique design. However, while Project Azorian's results were mixed, to say the least, the barge's ability to work in secrecy made it an ideal home for the Navy's next groundbreaking project. Inside the steel walls of HMB-1, Lockheed Martin oversaw the construction of the Sea Shadow IX-529. For days on end, a small four-man crew worked in isolated modules, each piece of the ship fabricated by different manufacturers, ensuring that no single company could make out the final design. To maintain absolute discretion, every operation requiring the roof of the Hughes mining barge to open was meticulously timed in order to avoid the watchful eyes of Soviet satellites passing overhead. After all, it was the final stages of the Cold War, and even the faintest glimpse of the project could unravel Skunkworks' latest masterpiece. From the air to the seas. Although details about the Sea Shadow's design remain sparse, much can be assessed from her angular, faceted shape. The model was undoubtedly inspired by the first-generation F-117 stealth fighter, the starting point of the entire concept. As veteran Pentagon observant Stan Zimmerman joked, quote, "If you put wings on it and cut off the pontoons, you could probably fly it." Because of this uncanny resemblance, the Sea Shadow's design owes much to Lockheed's Echo 1 program, pioneering computer software that allowed engineers to predict how shapes scattered radar waves, resulting in the sharp, faceted appearance shared by early stealth projects. Stealth at sea, however, involves a lot more than radar, as infrared sensors, sonar, and even a ship's own wake can betray their own position. Thankfully, the Sea Shadow's aforementioned SWAT, or Small Waterplane Area Twin Hull Design, tackled these challenges. With its submerged pontoons connected to the main hull by thin struts, the wake was minimized, allowing her noisier diesel-electric propulsion components to stay above the waterline, making them harder to detect. The exhaust vents between the struts further reduced heat signatures, masking the ship from prying infrared sensors, while the ship's inward sloping sides also scattered radar waves, making detection even more difficult. As such, despite its unconventional shape, the Navy's Sea Shadow could remain stable in even the roughest seas. Inside, the ship offered basic accommodations, including 12 bunks, a microwave, a refrigerator, and a table. And while she was never commissioned nor mission capable, she earned a spot in the Naval Vessel Register as a groundbreaking test bed. Testing. The Sea Shadow was never intended as a warship. With its limited speed of 13 knots, unconventional design, and inability to carry heavy weapons, its purpose was singular: research. Safely secured inside the 180-foot-long, 70-foot-high enclosure of HMB-1, the Sea Shadow underwent repairs and maintenance during the day. By night, however, the sneaky operators flooded ballast tanks, sinking the interior floor beneath the surrounding seawater to allow the new ship to quietly glide in and out, hidden from view. During her initial sea trials, the Sea Shadow left behind large wakes that could be easily spotted on radar and from the air. The cause was puzzling, undermining the very stealth it was designed to achieve. It wasn't long before the crew uncovered the issue. The motor propellers had been installed backward. Once corrected, the ship performed as intended, steadily proving its experimental capabilities. Night trials were conducted in 1985 and 1986, focusing on testing the SWAT hull, refining automation to reduce crew size, enhancing stability in rough seas, and improving radar and sonar capabilities. The ship was outfitted with several cameras throughout to minimize the need for personnel, while her interior provided ample room for experimentation. According to a former crew member, quote, "We operated during the night with impunity. We could disappear and sneak up on whomever we wanted. Nobody thought we could do that." The Sea Shadow's stability in rough waters was nothing short of extraordinary. The same sailor remarked that in 12-foot waves, a glass of soda placed on the bridge barely moved. Her performance often outclassed her Navy and Coast Guard escorts, who were forced to turn back during sea conditions with 8 to 12-foot waves, while she carried on, seemingly without issue. Premier platform. But the Sea Shadow's experimental nature extended far beyond her stealth capabilities. During her trials, the Navy called her, quote, "the premier test platform for ship stealth and experimental technologies." Built without a rudder, she relied entirely on stabilizers for steering, making every docking maneuver that much more impressive. When her fuel tanks took on water during one mission, instead of calling for a Navy tow, the four-person crew worked for 12 hours in complete darkness to restore an engine and bring her back safely. With no auxiliary power on board, they used flashlights and removed water bucket by bucket. Nonetheless, the results and specific details of the tests are unknown, and testing was suspended from 1986 all the way to 1993, all while the Sea Shadow remained a secret. In 1993, the public finally got its first glimpse of the experimental stealth ship, with initial testing wrapping up the following year. The ship's unique design likely inspired Hollywood. In the 1997 James Bond film Tomorrow Never Dies, the antagonist used the fictional Dolphin II, a stealth ship eerily similar to the Sea Shadow, to destroy a Royal Navy frigate and nearly spark World War III. The Sea Shadow underwent further trials in 1999 and remained in service throughout 2006. During these years, Lockheed Martin managed and maintained both the experimental vessel and HMB-1 under Navy oversight. When the Navy decided to part ways with the vessel, she was offered for sale and even as a museum donation. But when no takers were found, in 2012, Both the Sea Shadow and HMB-1 were dismantled and scrapped. Nonetheless, the technology pioneered by the Sea Shadow lives on. The Sea Shadow's stabilizer and canard system has been adopted by the USNS Impeccable and Victorious ocean surveillance ships, aiding in their stability-sensitive intelligence missions. Lessons from her design also influenced advancements in submarine periscopes and stealth features, while her testing contributed to the development of modern U.S. Navy warships, including the cutting-edge Zumwalt-class destroyers.